so dry. So, you know, that will be taken into consideration, and they will have to come out with the fire department for certain things after, you know, after construction of the homes. Also, streets and fire hydrants will be required to be installed before they can ever drop them in construction.
Okay, I think what residents are stating is that all her concerns are just coming from one out of the other.
Let me finish.
So she's just making a statement saying, what are you to expect, or you guys would expect, you have 36 homes being developed. If this is concerns, concerns are with developers, work ethic, or work ethic and quality of life being or lack of them caring for the quality of life of the residents that live there now with dumping the trash and whatnot. The concern is, what do we expect when you have all these homes and this massive construction site? You know, if it's one home and this is all these issues that are coming up, this is one home. I think that's what you're trying to get across to the neighbors.
Right. I'm not sure what's going on in this one house. I've been to a couple other houses that the same developers built. I've never on any of them seen them walk the road or not have bathrooms and facilities there for their workers.
I have photos.
I believe you. I don't understand. I've never been there. I can get photos of the other ones that I've been on. I don't know what
you want. It's quite obvious that you guys have two knowledge of people work in another building, and we live there. You need to go up to Rising Drive to see where the emergency trucks are going. Go up to Paradise, go down Forest Park Drive, and you take a fire truck and a trash truck to see if you can get to there.
So is your question, have they been up there? Have they been up there?
No, they have
not. Is that your question?
I measured today, it's 20 feet wide.
The street from sidewalk to curb to curb? There's no curb.
It's the same, bro. I'm not sure. 20 feet.
No, curb to curb.
It's the same. How far is it from curb to garage?
Well,
it depends
on where the property line is. The property line is 3 feet away from the garage base. You can say, tell the city, you can't buy my road to your ownership, but they don't want you to spend it. On this lot here, there are requirements to put a turnaround at the end of it so that when the fire trucks and garbage trucks come in, they'll be able to turn around without having to stop back here.
At the end of which street?
Barrel.
And a barrel is going to be required to turn around.
That's for this house. You won't be able to turn around. And maybe not, it'll be better for you guys, at least it'll be a place to turn around. I don't know. They all require us to put a turnaround in there.
Who's they? Is it?
The city.
You're assigned.
Ask all my questions at once, or one
how many questions
one
do you
time
have?
Okay. Like three, maybe?
That's are they all related?
Okay.
Yeah.
How? Why do you want it's the same builders doing these houses and the two up here on Reynolds Reynolds?
Yes.
The two homes there are the same builders. So why are you trying to distance yourselves from these houses, even though it's a separate project, and you do such bad work than these two, and you don't want to be connected with these. The first thing you guys do when you show up is you ask the neighbors for water and electricity.
That's
the neighbors.
Not the
I know that none of the supervisors ask.
Wait, are you at all connected to this single home development that's going on?
The only thing that we are the civil engineer on the project. So the only thing that we do is we do the tentative map design, we do the applications and we do the infrastructure improvements, sewer water storm, or sewer storm drain streets, water facilities. So we have nothing to do with anything after those.
Okay, so your question to them is why are you trying to distance yourself from that?
Yeah, because it's the same home.
Mr. Monroe?
It's the same home. And as far as that street being only 20 feet wide, one end, right at the curb, it goes straight down 12 feet into people's patio. The other side, because that's their garage, right at the street, is 20 feet wide. There's no way
to go to barrel.
Where all these streets on the hill, it doesn't go by what the map says.
I don't know, they're already
in the woods. And what's the square footage of the largest house? What's the square footage of the smallest? Because Raymond said they were only like 1,000 square feet.
Well,
so
they're in the top. But they're not huge houses.
So the largest, you have a square footage? A lot of ice run.
Unfortunately, the architect is also having medical issues. He's had problems, which, and they threw him in writing. So I brought the architectural to my cat.
Another big old block up 18th Street on the Batman Center. I think this could be done responsibly, but you have to take accountability. You just have to, or you're going to have your neighbors, you know, back you up. And that's basically, I think, the main constraints on. Also, if you're only taking 15,000 cubic feet, are you guys doing caissons? Is that basically what you're doing? Well, not much less, you have to get to that, right? So, I mean, for me, there's many concerns here, but I think if you guys took our concerns seriously, and we gave them an opportunity to keep the work, because I think a lot of these people have concerns, but at the first meeting they said it was a question of 27 houses, and then it jumped up to 10 houses, which means more families, more congestion, but I think you guys got to have a medium to there and have the space to where it'll flow. I think it will have a better reception.
I'm sorry, when you say caissons?
Caissons are, they're kind of like they go into...
So are you saying the houses will be on still?
No, they'll actually go into the bedrock.
So they can stabilize them on the ground. Okay.
Basically, the hill slides away, the house will remain standing. That's after the fish, that's what I'm
talking
about. So for me, being in this neighborhood, we really can't, I mean, my guy has been here for 113 years on Amethyst. And if we had that attitude of new people coming in of any sort, I mean, my family would say, oh, what the hell with everybody? You know, there was congestion. I mean, that's when my driver's still creepy and calls was still creepy. So we have to be accountable, but we also have to have discretion. You know, some discretion in the building. And don't lie, because then we know what lies are. So that's the big problem with spending that there. But you don't know. Be accountable on your side, because I think you could, or you guys can win these people over if you stay accountable and responsible. So I have to.
Thank you, Mr. Floyd. Ma'am?
Hi, my name is Dolphy. I came here today to find out about this development, specifically the impact that if there was going to be a variance for the Northeast Hillside zoning ordinance, which was put in place a few years ago to protect El Sereno and neighboring communities from bad developments. Unlike Mount Washington, Mulholland, we don't have a specific plan in place that ensures that we get excellent developments in our hillside neighborhoods. That's what the hillside zoning ordinance is supposed to try and get for us. But I had experience with the Elephant Hill development, and those guys came in and their business model was, I'm going to do all this work here, I'm going to do all these plans here, I'm going to go through the city, and then once I get everything approved, I'm going to sell it to somebody to build.
Exactly.
And it's called speculation. And so I preface my comments about that because really who we need to be talking to is the council office and the planning department. And we need to say, we want a full EIR, no mitigated negative declaration, no negative declaration, we need the full EIR. And so if you could move over a little bit so I can see those plans. You said that you were in the conceptual stage, that nothing had been finalized. You also said you were going to have a xeriscape, which means that there's going to be desert landscaping. That looks like it's something out of Northern California and hillside in, you know, the Bay Area. That's not LA. That would be fire inducing with all that growth around there. That would never happen under. So I think it's fair for the community to understand exactly what you're developing, and the developer should be here because at the end of the day, he's the one who's accountable to this community. But the way the system works with speculative development, it doesn't matter what you put out there, because at the end of the day, he's trying to sell it to somebody who's going to build it, and he's going to walk away with all the money, and then when the problems happen, because all of these hillsides are unstable, you know that from Monterey Hills condos, they slid down the hill. There's people who live on college who remember those condos sliding down the hill.
I did it for much time.
So, my question is, how much grade are you going to grade to bedrock and then fill and perhaps fill? Okay, all right, that's a good question. raise a bid, run a maze, get a bill, and then come back to soil, and then you run.
And they said no.
No, everything could be built on case on anything that the soil engineer recognizes as unstable, stable.
Have you done a soil in the report?
We have done a preliminary soil report.
Have you done a full soil report? Full soil report should be done where they're drilling down and they're seeing that there's water underneath the soil. There is water all over these hills.
Really.
It just stays in there. And if that hasn't been done, then this development should not take place.
We have done a soil report to that level.
You have that soil report?
Yes.
City has it. We're waiting for our...
We saw the soil report for Elephant Hill and it said nothing about the underground water. So, is the hillside zoning ordinance, is this project subject to the hillside zoning ordinance?
Baseline hillside ordinance?
No. The northeast hillside
is? I believe it is. I'm not positive, but I believe it is.
Okay, so what's the process of getting the variance and the hillside zoning ordinance kicking in?
What variance are you talking about? We're not requesting a variance.
You're not requesting a variance for the hillside zoning ordinance?
Well, the only thing that I know that we have to worry about is the ridgeline in this area. Part of their North Hills.
Northeast Hillside Zone.
Right. So I'm an item that affects this property, plus a small lot subdivision ordinance itself allows a certain rights that don't require there.
So
which parts of ordinance are your concern?
Floor area ratio and grading on the ridge lines.
Right. We follow the whole ordinance about the grading on the ridge line. So we follow the city's requirements for the floor area ratio.
Per the Northeast Hillside zoning ordinance?
As far as I know.
They have requested a zone change.
Which is like a huge deal.
Okay, well the zone change only affects the whether we're doing R1 development, which is 5,000 square foot lots, and a home on 5,000 square foot lots with a floor area ratio that will then be based upon the topography of a 5,000 square foot lot versus what we did was requested a zone change to what they call an RD5, which means that development of houses you can develop. If you take the acreage and divide it by 5,000, it tells you the maximum number of houses that can be built. But you don't have to have 5,000 square feet per lot. The minimum is 600. We know that our lots are bigger than that. Because I would never put anything on 600 square foot lot. I mean, that just doesn't make sense.
How much of these houses?
We have absolutely no idea.
Sure you do.
I'm the engineer. I have no idea.
You're a developer, though.
Well, the developer has not shared that information with me, and to the best of my recollection, I do not believe that was
2,000 square feet. So, what's a 2,000 square foot house cost in Montecito Heights?
I have no idea.
I'm not a realtor. I'm not a developer. I know.
But I think that's going to be over $500,000.
Right. Based on
how many people here can afford $500,000 for $500,000 house? So nobody in this neighborhood is going to be able to buy that house. So what's going to happen? Is what would have happened on Elephant Hill, the gentrification. And eventually, you know, that all those improvements that they're talking about that should be already in place in your neighborhood for a development like this to happen. They're not going to pay for it. They're not paying for it. Otherwise, they would say to you, we're going to widen your street to 40, the standard 40 feet. These guys are speculators.
I mean, you guys are.
And the thing that I would recommend that everybody do is contact the research office and contact the head of planning, Michael Lagrande, and you guys can circulate some contact information and say, we want a full EIR, and we're opposed to speculative.
In my discussions with the person who is backing this development.
to build it. They intend to build it. It means that at this point, the intent is not to take it to the tentative stage and the tentative approve itself to somebody else. The intent is to take it to the tentative stage, then go and get the final map recorded. In order to record the final map, there are certain things that will be required. One of them is to submit the infrastructure improvement plans to do the streets and the sewer and the storm drain. We don't know whatever the city requirement is, whatever is in the general plan for the streets. Not all streets in the city are 40 feet. Some are 20, some are 28, some are 36, some are 40, some are 60. It depends what's in the general plan document for the area. And the Bureau of Engineering, I know the engineer who does tracks, is very good about holding the developments to task for what is in the general plan.
You seem to really very bad development.
Okay, I have not developed in this community prior, but it is not my we pride ourselves in following the code, listening to the city, listening to the communities, and developing developments that are good and sustainable, and working with builders that we hope have the same vision. Okay. So I can't address the developer because I'm not the developer. He's sick. He thought he was.
He was at the last meeting. So we need to. Did you answer the question?
They want an EIR. Like I said, you're not going to get a categorical exemption. We know that. You're going to get negative declaration. Possibly, like I said. The indication is that they're going to require an EIR. I will know more on Thursday because I just got the email this morning. My meeting is on Thursday. So, and I will be very happy to send you an email and let you know what it tells us. Because it's going to be public
today.
Greg Shute, the environmental planner on this case.
He's actually the planning guy at the planning department who has the application. Very earnest. You are not
route that wants to take, we'll recommend something, they'll tell us what it has to be. The hearing, you guys can go to the hearing, talk to them, and say, look, we want to stay with the roads, only, you know, whatever feet wide, there's not a lot of room for there, and you will have your stay in the hall route as well as the owner does. You have the exact same stay in the hall route as the owner does.
Is there a hearing?
No.
No. Yeah, at this moment in time, it's another thing that we will address in the environmental meeting as to whether, generally with track developments, they have been leaning towards having the hall route hearings at the same time with the track and all the associated hearings occurred. But in certain cases, they do also have separate. So that will also be addressed in Thursday's meeting, whether or not they're going to want the hall route as part of the overall hearing, or whether they're going to want a separate hearing to address the hall route specifically because it's hillside, the amount of dirt being moved, et cetera. Okay. The R1 to the RD5. The RD5 is required for small lot. You have to have a, even though the small lot subdivision is single family homes, you have to have a multi, because of the clustering of the homes and the reduced setbacks that are allowed under the small lot subdivision, you have to have what they call a multi-family zoning in order to develop that kind of development. Our intent, my intent in proposing a small lot was to reduce the amount of grading, reduce the impact on the hillside, because my concern as a planner is the environment. And it's the overall environment and how not how it's not only going to impact the people that are going to move into these homes, but also the people that are around those homes. Because if we start grading 30,000 square cubic yards, that's a lot of dirt, but if we can keep it to 15,000 and still get a nice number of homes to create a community, then that's what we're trying to do. So that was the reason for the zone change, was to help preserve the more of the hillside, reduce the grade, but still create a nice community.
So should you get this zone change, should it be granted, and then the project begins to be developed but then fall through, that property is then changed. That property, the zoning is then changed for that. So it stays, identity becomes open to the possibility of just not suitable for it if you're having to go through a lot of extra work for it.
So you have one on the clarification on the plans and the hillside evidence?
Right. So, yeah, we're under the amount that you require, we're under 1,000 square feet per lot. We're allowed 1,000 square feet.
What's the height of the
building? Most, a lot of them are one story, one or two stories. And also depends on where it is in the grid line. We are probably going to be able to do that below. Some of them, no, we're going to have a third story down the hill, one or two story houses. And on the uphill side, there's an uphill, down the side, it's one story at the street level, and one story down the hill. So I don't think there's any huge.
So you have complaints
with
your training, routine
wall
restrictions?
Yeah, everything's under, well, retain wall structure is nothing higher than 12 feet or 2 tenths of walls. We have that. So if you look at the map, it actually has all the retaining wall heights on them. I think there was one, we have one spot where we're going to have to ask for variance maybe when we get into engineering. But other than that, the way the buildings are sitting under the 20 foot height.
What is
the spot height? Well, it's 2 tenths of wall.
And then her final was on the small lot ordinance.
I don't know if they can do anything. Yeah, we actually thought about that from the start. We've done other small lot jobs, hillside jobs, but you know, nothing of this stature. I don't know if there's any of this extent of small lots. We have done other hillside small lots.